Good afternoon, and welcome to our Good Friday online service. Our service today is a contemplative service. It is based around some reflections and music. The reflections are based on the Stations of the Cross. Some of them. The Stations of the Cross have formed part of our Christian tradition at Passiontide for many centuries, because they enable us to engage actively with the path of suffering walked by Jesus Christ. So we'll have some reflections, and in between the reflections we'll have some music. And like I said, the purpose is to enable us to engage with the path of suffering walked by Jesus Christ. I'll start the service with a couple of collect prayers for Good Friday. Let us pray. Almighty Father, look with mercy on this your family, for which our Lord Jesus Christ was content to be betrayed and given up into the hands of sinners and to suffer death upon the cross, who is alive and glorified with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Eternal God, in the cross of Jesus we see the cost of our sin and the depth of your love. In humble hope and fear, may we place at his feet all that we have and all that we are, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
There are times when silence matters more than words. When some of us read parts for our online recorded service last Palm Sunday for a rendition of The Passion According to Mark, no one spoke at the end for quite a while, which says something in itself. The power of the narrative, the pace, the clarity of it left us dumbfounded There are circumstances which I am sure that we can all relate to, where our keeping silence has been brought about through awe or through admiration, or it's the cautious choice, or it's the cowardly choice in failure to speak up, or if we cannot add anything constructive, the sensible choice. There is the silence of deep grief, despair, the silence where there are no words because of shock or deep wounding, or even because there is no point. There are no words, there's nothing to be said, because to justify or explain will be to no avail. That is the most tragic silence, perhaps. Communication is lost, barriers are up. The Sanhedrin, breaking all its own rules, had met in the dark of the night after the betrayal, arrest, and bringing of Jesus into their custody for questioning. And first light saw the whole council gathered together to confirm the conclusions to which they had come about Jesus. His teachings and his life had led to an inevitable collision with the established religious orders. Their goal was ensuring the implementation of the death penalty, and that was not within their powers in Roman-dominated Judea without securing a conviction before the governor, Pontius Pilate. So as we reflect on this part of the story, where Jesus is condemned to death by crucifixion, a common, brutal death for insurrectional criminality in Roman times, we should understand that this condemnation was secured through local political expediency, charge manipulation, and a substitution of prisoners, rather than any proof whatsoever against Jesus. Jesus, condemned to death, begs the question, for what and by whom? Claiming to be the Messiah? Blasphemy did not count much with Pilate, who was more interested in the political rather than the religious aspects of the case. His main aim was to prevent riots and to get through the Passover period in Jerusalem without major trouble and assert his own authority in the power play between himself and the chief priests. For what? Calling himself a king? King of the Jews, an evolved and political charge and label by the time Jesus was handed over to Pilate for questioning. That was more concerning and actionable. And therefore, Pilate's questioning of Jesus emphasized the role of kingship as he saw it, not as Jesus did. The truth about this, as enacted when he rode into Jerusalem a few days before, hailed by his followers with shouts of Hosanna, very different from what Pilate's thoughts may have been. In Mark's account, apart from his answer to Pilate's question, "Are you the king of the Jews?" to which Jesus replies, "You've said so," Jesus remains silent from then onwards until that last terrible cry from the cross. Jesus' silence had also exasperated the chief priests during the Sanhedrin trial, and Pilate remains astonished that Jesus makes no answer to any of the charges made by the priests in his presence either. Within this fast-moving narrative, Mark wants to be sure that we, the listeners and the readers, think of Jesus's death in terms of his messiahship. Jesus had already spoken about his death as symbolizing the reversal of the world's power structures. And now he was about to fulfill his own words. Jesus is not only silent, but he is innocent. And even Pilate knows that he's done nothing wrong. the ancient custom of the releasing to the people of a prisoner at the time of the Passover festival provided Pilate with a way of offering to release Jesus without passing sentence. But the crowd demanded the release of a notable rebel, Barabbas, whom they may have been waiting to see and inclined to support anyway. Incited further by the priests at Pilate's every question, the crowd howls for the crucifixion of Jesus instead. A guilty man freed and an innocent one condemned. And wishing to appease the mob and see the matter resolved, Pilate authorized the death sentence, and he had Jesus cruelly scourged before handing him over to be crucified. In addition to proclaiming who Jesus is, and therefore who God is, Mark's final chapters also notably highlight the failures of discipleship and the falling away of supporters in Jesus' final days. As we gaze on this scene as described by Mark, I invite you to reflect on the silence of Jesus in these circumstances, and on his innocence, and on his suffering. The majesty of Christ is nowhere more evident in the gospel than at his trial. It's not the prisoner who's judged, but the scheming ecclesiastical authorities, the baying crowd, and the governor who appeases. This is the story of Jesus in whose footsteps we follow, which is the story of the love of God doing for us what we could not do for ourselves. And I end with a verse from Isaiah chapter 15. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth.
The way we may watch. Our reflections this Good Friday are based on the Stations of the Cross. The scourging and mocking of Jesus as King of the Jews by the Roman soldiers is the sixth station in the Anglican list, and the seventh station is Jesus carrying the cross, which hardly gets a mention in Mark's Gospel. The Roman governor, Pilate, has agreed to have Jesus crucified on the basis that the Jewish authorities, the Sanhedrin, said that he was claiming to be King of the Jews. The Sanhedrin's real complaint is, however, that he was claiming to be the Messiah, something in which the Romans were really not interested. Pilate knows that the claim by the Sanhedrin about Jesus claiming to be King of the Jews is false, but is content to appease the Jewish authorities. His revenge is to put the claim on the cross not as a claim by Jesus, but as a statement that he is the King of the Jews, something the Jews objected to, as recorded in John's Gospel. The irony of the Jewish authorities asking the Romans, the occupying power, to execute someone who claimed to be King of the Jews would not have been lost on the Roman soldiers who mocked him. The soldiers would have been in the front line of confronting and suppressing revolts by the Jewish population. Among the cohort, equivalent to a small battalion, involved in mocking Jesus would have been a centurion who would have commanded the detachment, equivalent to a company, responsible for guarding and supervising the actual crucifixion. When he saw Jesus die, he is reported in Mark's and Matthew's Gospels as saying, "Truly, this man was God's son." In Luke, he is reported as saying that Jesus was innocent, and in John, he reports on Jesus being pierced by the spear after he was dead. The centurion was regarded personally as a reliable source by the Christian community. So what should we take away from the approach of the Jewish and Roman authorities to the crucifixion of Jesus? How would we have reacted to the claims that Jesus was the Messiah and King of the Jews? Would we have believed them? The Pharisees and other religious who witnessed the crucifixion wanted Jesus to come down from the cross himself and show his power. In addition to showing himself as the Messiah and King of the Jews, he had also promised to rebuild the temple, although it had not been destroyed at the time of the crucifixion, but it had by the time the Gospels were written. The rebuilding of the temple was Jesus' reference to his own body that would be restored and resurrected 3 days after his death. In reflecting on Good Friday and the crucifixion, while we can and should consider the events that led to Jesus' death, more important is understanding the relationship of Jesus, the Messiah, to God and his quotation from Psalm 22, my God, why have you forsaken me?" immediately before his death, and the centurion recognizing that he was the Son of God. If we take one reflection away today, it is that Jesus died for our sins. We then need to look forward to Easter Day and the resurrection.
We've grown used to the crucifixion story. It no longer has the power to shock us, even to move us as it should with tears. Our gospel passage is prosaic, almost devoid of detail and seemingly of judgment. But consider this. For the crowds flocking into Jerusalem for the feast of the Passover, the crucifixion was no big deal. For the Roman army of occupation, or peacekeeping force as some would have it, the crucifixion was just another day at the office. The contemporary historian Josephus tells horrifying tales of crucifixion, hundreds dispatched that way on both sides in the Maccabean Wars, for they were whipped with rods, and their bodies were torn to pieces and were crucified were they still alive and breathed, he writes. This was happening 100 years or so before Jesus was born. And then, at around the time of his birth, after the death of Herod the Great, there were outbreaks of revolt, especially in Galilee. The Roman legate Varius sent in 2 legions to harry and pillage and take revenge. Josephus writes, he punished some that were most guilty. Now the number that were crucified in this amount were 2,000. Years later, Josephus describes how the Romans crucified many before the walls of Jerusalem during the Great Siege. The idea was to terrorize the population and force surrender. The number of victims reached 500 a day at one point, until there was no wood left in the surrounding country to make more crosses. So as much as the idea of crucifixion may make us shudder today, no doubt the population of Judea had become inured to its horrors. But in fact, it was worse than that. As Pope Benedict points out in his book on Holy Week, in Roman criminal law, anyone sentenced to death had first to undergo a scourging. They were whipped and tortured, and then they were beaten up. Then they had to carry the instrument of their death sentence to the place of execution. Well, a few years ago, I found myself lost in the northwest of the old city of Jerusalem. I was looking for the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, which is allegedly the site of the crucifixion. And what struck me as I scurried up and down the stepped alleys was just how steep the terrain was. To expect Jesus, in his physically traumatized condition, to scrabble his way there, burdened by the cross, seems senselessly cruel. Eventually, Simon of Cyrene, an innocent bystander, is press-ganged into posterity, his life unexpectedly transformed forever. In his book, Jesus and the Eyewitnesses, Richard Bachman suggests that Mark relies on Simon's testimony for his gospel account. Perhaps his sons, Rufus and Alexander, were still alive when the gospel was written, faithfully recounting their father's stories of the crucifixion to a growing band of Jesus' followers. Simon would also have been a witness to the hard-bitten soldiers carelessly throwing dice to see who would carry off Christ's expensive purple robe. He would have observed what was perhaps a small measure of sympathy as Jesus offered a mixture of wine and myrrh, a narcotic blend that helped to lessen pain. But Jesus refused it. And then Simon would have seen Jesus suffer more as the brutal Roman soldiers with huge nails and ropes manhandled him and fixed him to the cross. This grotesque scene from 2,000 years ago still touches the Jesus followers today. George MacLeod, who founded the Iona community, once famously argued that the cross be raised again at the centre of the marketplace as well as the steeple of the church. He says, I am recovering the claim that Jesus was not crucified in a cathedral between 2 candles, but on a cross between 2 thieves, on a town garbage heap, at a crossroad of politics so cosmopolitan that they had to write his title in Hebrew and in Latin and in Greek, at the kind of place where cynics talk smut and thieves curse and soldiers gamble. Because that is where he died. That is what he died about. That is where Christ's own ought to be. And that is what church people ought to be about. Yes, indeed. Amen to that.
Matthew O'Reilly, an emergency medical technician in New York State critical care unit, describes in his TED talk, the online equivalent of Speaker's Corner, how he has experienced in his career as an emergency medical carer, how people react to imminent death. He talks about how people who are in terrible accidents or are about to have a cardiac arrest live their final moments, and how he as a carer engages with them. And he tells how it doesn't actually matter where people come from, what their background is, or whether they're religious or not. There's typically three things that they wonder about and that they are preoccupied with when they're faced with imminent death. And he says these three things are, number one, forgiveness, where every one of us, when we come to the time of death and dying, feel that there are things that in our lives we should have done differently, and we have the need and feel the urge to ask for forgiveness. And so with no one else around but just a emergency critical care, they speak to these people dying, to the carers who are around them, and ask for forgiveness. He tells the story of an elderly gentleman who knows he's going to die and basically says, I should have spent more time with my grandchildren. I have been selfish with my time. The second is remembrance, how everyone who realizes that their life is coming to an end hopes that there will be people who will remember, who will keep a memory of them and keep thereby their lives relevant to others, keep that life alive in remembrance. And then finally, there is meaning. Everyone dying thinks back, even in those very short moments, and even when people have just suffered a terrible accident, they think back over their life and they hope that it has had some impact on the world and that it has brought meaning to people. As we are reflecting on this Good Friday, on Jesus' death, I want to take these three aspects of how people think about their imminent death and reflect on and meditate on Jesus on the cross, the man knowing that he is about to die, and what the Bible tells us of this man hanging on the cross, helpless, suffering, tortured, his strength evaporating, and knowing that he is about to leave this life behind. What does Jesus say about forgiveness? And we know that Jesus on the cross, unlike all other humans, and a human he is because he dies on that cross, Jesus does not ask for forgiveness for himself. What he does, even before he goes to the cross, and as he's being taken to the cross and by his torturers, he says, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." He says that in Luke 23, verse 24. So unlike all of us, he's not asking for forgiveness for the things that he has done in this life or should have done in this life and never managed to do. But he thinks of us. He even thinks of those who torture him, and he asks for forgiveness for them. Remembrance. Jesus does want to be remembered. And he says that to his friends, to his disciples, on that last supper that they share together, when he knows that he will die, that this is the last time that they will be together and share this meal together. And as we celebrate in the Eucharist, he then first gives the cup, but then shares the food. And as he shares and breaks the bread, he says, "Remember me, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." So Jesus tells us, tells his friends, tells us that we ought to remember him. And as he hangs on the cross, he is asking us, "Remember me." Finally, meaning. What meaning has Jesus' life? Well, even if you don't believe in Christ the Redeemer, Christ the Savior of the world, you would have to recognize that this man changed the world, changed humanity. Across the world, wherever you go, this is the most known person in history, and someone who has changed countless lives and has changed the very course of history. But perhaps more importantly, as Paul says in his letter to the Romans, Romans 8 verses 38 to 39, it's that famous statement of St. Paul saying how much Jesus has changed his life. "I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord." inseparable from Christ's love, whether death or life or any powers. Jesus has transformed the world. This is what we believe. On Good Friday, he hangs on that cross as a dead man, leaving us seemingly behind. Steve Jobs, in an address to the graduates on graduation day at Stanford University, gave a speech in 2005. And he, at the time, had just heard that he had been diagnosed with cancer, but had actually been cleared, and believed that he would hopefully live decades, as he says in the speech then. 5 years later, he died of cancer. But he said at the time that realizing that we must die was one of the most important things for him in his life, to reshape how he approached every day. And he said the following to the young students sitting in front of him. He said, "Remember that you must die. It makes you aware that you have nothing to lose. You are already naked. Jesus is naked on that cross. He is dying and he dies. He has seemingly lost everything. He has nothing left to lose." Amen.
The tomb was where the story was supposed to end. It was to be a cautionary tale that warned others of what the powerful can do to the weak when threatened. The dead do not return to life. Having laid Jesus in the tomb, there wasn't any expectation of more to come. The Jesus story was over. Now the long wait for the Messiah would continue. The people who scourged him went away patting themselves on the back for a job well done. The Pilate who judged him washed his hands off the whole affair and returned to more important matters. The priests and the scribes who orchestrated his murder went back to the temple to pray and offer sacrifices to God. The crowd that was vehement in yelling, "Crucify him," dispersed, all of them returning to their homes and their lives. That an innocent man was tortured and murdered counted for nothing. What mattered most was for order to be restored and the status quo protected. Didn't the high priest himself say, "It is better for one man to die for the people than for the whole nation to perish"? O God, where are you when evil people prosper? Look and see how they spill the blood of the innocent. Many are the powerful who act without regard for the agency of a sovereign and all-powerful God. Motivated by fear and selfish ambition, they are blind to God's will and purpose. They made their evil plans, but they reckoned without God in the way that self-serving human beings always do. If they had any understanding of the divine plan, they would not have missed the invisible hand of God in action. Did they not hear what Prophet Isaiah said centuries ago? "Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his stripes we are healed. He was oppressed and was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him." They conspired to put Jesus Christ to death and congratulated themselves on a job well done. In their willful ignorance, however, they did not realize that it was the will of the Lord to crush him. They conspired to put him to death, but it was the will of God that he should die. God planned it all and accomplished it by means of wicked human beings. They meant his death for evil, but God meant it for good. So they placed the light of the world in a dark tomb, hoping to extinguish it forever. From a human perspective, it appears to be the end. From God's perspective, however, what looks like the end is really the cusp of a new beginning. Christ is in the tomb, but the Jesus story does not end in the tomb. On Good Friday, we wait with Christ in the tomb. We wait with Christ in anticipation of his glorious resurrection. Christ breaks chains and sets free. Death cannot overcome him. The shackles of hell cannot restrain him. We have hope because Jesus Christ lives. Good Friday is good because Jesus Christ has conquered the grave. Amen. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.